Everybody has a mosh pit. Huddles, football.
In some facet, everyone has a mosh pit. Yeah.
Elaborate.
I mean, everybody has a group get together, like whether it's a huddle or
at a wedding when they when
back
they
to the pile the,
when they go for the garter belt or whatever.
Baseball slap you on the ass.
Is that a mosh pit? Mosh pit in that ass.
Yeah, I guess. Have you ever been in a mosh pit?
Yeah, it was like.
And who was playing? What was it? A music mosh pit? What
was it? Was it a CPR fest?
It was like a small Linkin Park. Yeah, CPR.
We just randomly like. Throughout,
but it wasn't like, yeah, it was just honestly just
did you make contact?
It wasn't like straight up hardcore.
Do you feel the music or do you have a strategy going in? Or do you just like, I've become so or are you like, all right, I'm gonna do this, you know?
I don't think you would call it a real mosh pit though. I think it was like more of a like
did you make
bouncing back into each other a few times. Like I've seen mosh pits where I went to like when Saliva one of the bands came, and it's like that was a mosh pit. That was like
were people bleeding?
It's like amateur pro. So like if you went to like a Pantera concert, I'm sure you'd have a bloody eye and like possibly a broken jaw or something.
It's like the closest thing to like seeing like Celine Dion live in concert. You get a little more
a Celine Dion mosh pit. What is the Titanic song starts playing, and then all of a sudden these people start looking at each other and they go, now slamming
into each other. I mean, everybody has a mosh pit.
Yeah,
everybody.
You're right.
All right. So we got a movie that you brought us a clip of. Let me show it.
Oh, you want to get right off to the movie?
I want to see a little clip.
All right.
First, let's get into our sponsors, though.
Do it, man.
Gulf South Productions. Shout out to Danielle and the team.
Absolutely.
Sound audio. We got you. They got you. They're great. Who do you want to go next with?
Golden Gulf Insurance. Might as well. Best insurance company on the coast.
This is true.
Home, auto, commercial, bonds, and soon to be life and health.
Yeah, soon.
Nice.
So,
and then Loxicom.
What?
Because Pete's just super smart. And if you need any smart house stuff,
home automation.
Yeah, it's crazy stuff. Yeah. He's also really big into crypto.
I like his logo.
I do Lighthouse. Sick.
Mm.
All right. Lighthouse. Roll that beautiful
please.
Theme.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah. So, The Stokes River Haunting is a movie that I've been working on for going on a year now, written by Josh Price and adapted a little bit by us. But anyways, it's been a journey, man. I'll tell y'all about it. But anyways, this is the first teaser. Oh, there it is. This is the first teaser for The Stokes River Haunting.
The curse is pain. It flows through time like a river.
Kimberly. Holy cow. So what, you got about 72 hours just into that little 30-second clip right there? Or what?
It was crunch time. So, you know, I have a superpower called procrastination, and I've procrastinated on this for quite some time, but CoastCon's coming up. I had to get it out there, man. We've got probably about 4 days left of filming. We're going to do one of the shoots in the first weekend of April, and then we're going to do the second one towards the end of April. And then after that, it's just balls to the wall editing. And that's where, I mean, that could be a couple months because I'm a perfectionist and, you know, it's never good enough.
Yeah. I know what we put into our 2 minute long videos. So I can only imagine.
Right? Yeah. People don't understand how much goes into editing. But nowadays, like with computers and everything else, they can just plug in templates and everything.
Is there a future in it for AI and editing?
That's what I was thinking about the other day when I saw AI something or the other. And I was like, they're already there to a degree, but they've got sites, and I might be wrong a little bit about this, but where you can plug in business type, this, that, then they'll pull B-roll or stock footage and put it together, you know, like home healthcare for blah, blah, blah. And then you'll have like a shot of a woman and her, you know, son bringing her into the home healthcare unit. So yeah, I'm pretty sure there is, but it takes the soul out of it, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because they have AI VJs now on Sirius XM. They practice with it. So they took one guy's voice and they did a bunch of, I heard Howard Stern talking about it. They did a bunch of clips from him And so they had him VJ like a whole thing, you know, like a or DJ, yeah. radio DJ.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, coming up next is the hit from Red Hot Chili Peppers. It's Under the Bridge Downtown, you know, or whatever.
But was that the like the VJ? That was an actual
just AI his voice. Bot.
Yeah,
the bot was doing all the stuff. So he was saying, "It's like, all right, we're going to come back with you." With you know, he had his little sayings and stuff, but he knew when to insert them. So yeah, dude, I think AI is going to have a future in editing, and it's going to make it. To where
gotta be so much easier.
You're gonna have to just go above and beyond, you know, because it's you're gonna have to do like some old school, like when Scorsese was first starting off doing like Taxi Driver type stuff, where he was just going against the grain with, you know, he had people on that movie that were like, dude, we're not gonna do that. That breaks all the rules. And he's like, I don't care, it's my movie, you know.
And how much of that have you got to experience? Saying,
what's that?
I don't care, it's my movie. I mean, going against the grain or your own style. Like, you know, there's certain, I guess, filmmakers out there that you can tell right off the bat, like who they are, like the Coen brothers, like they have this certain yeah. like aura about them. Or what's the guy from The Righteous Tannenbaums? Or
yeah, I know you're talking about. Yeah, Wes.
Yeah, Wes Anderson.
Yeah, Wes Anderson.
So like you can tell it's his film right off right. the bat. Quentin Tarantino, same way they kind of got the, have you, I mean, where's that lie?
I don't know if it's just, I know that my DNA is in it to a degree, you know, there's a blueprint of what I like in there, but it's been a real team effort, man. And I'm the kind of person too, that, you know, at first I realized that egos, when it comes to working with people in film, you're not going to get a lot done because everybody has their certain thing. And what I'll do is I'll listen at least, you know, because I've been on a set with somebody before where it's like, you know, when everything was kind of dulled down and it's like, hey, maybe if you want to try, this might be an idea. Now, you know, they weren't absorbing anything. They weren't hearing it all. But
constructive criticism.
Right. So I think there's a lot of things that I don't know. And like, that's something like on Stokes. I have a director of photography, Christopher Bowler. He went to film school. This man is like, he's the lighting, the everything. He knows all this stuff, and he can make something like this cup on the table look like a cinematic, like something you'd pull right out of like a Francis Ford Coppola movie, you know, just because of what he does. So I'm still learning as I'm going. So I don't feel like I feel like, especially when the writing that I'm in there, that's where I'm at. But I think right now it's just a team effort. You know, it's anybody, you got an idea.
How many mistakes do y'all make?
A lot.
Like,
yeah. Well, we did the first, when we first with Stokes. Now Stokes was like first.
Well, what I was saying is like y'all working together, you're actually getting on that same wavelength.
Yeah.
To like work together and like not step on each other's feet. And when he started seeing your vision, like how long did it take for y'all to like him start seeing what you had an idea of?
Okay. After our first shoot in Franklinton, it was it was on me. I was unprepared. I had actors and actresses coming in from LA. We were all out at my dad's land in the middle of Franklinton, Louisiana. Everybody was running around like chickens with their head cut off. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, Erica Green, who's come in, she's worked on SAG sets and everything else. She said, "Let me help you organize for the next shoot." 'Cause that was just one shoot. And I said, "Please." Because that is not my expertise by any means. So she set up call sheets. She set up time. She set up all this stuff. And she made it to where we could do our job. So Bowler could focus on talking to me about what I see and making that come to life on camera. So I would say, like, instead of us being like, "Where's the props?" and blah, 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 "We got to get lunch for everybody. We're running around. There's some crazy meth guy asking for gasoline over there in the woods." Like, there was just all kinds of crazy crap happening, but we were organized. So now we don't step on each other's toes.
Yeah.
Now we're able to actually fit in on that gear of the whole machine, you know, like everybody playing their part, sound guy, lighting, this, that.
That's the most effective. I mean, whenever you got the machine oiled up and running smooth. All right. So I got a question. How Stokes, I mean, you didn't write it. Somebody else wrote it, right? So how did that become a project?
It was an idea that, my buddy Lee Turner and I had, we were sitting there talking about, we wanted to do just like a regular slasher movie.
So you did write it. Am I wrong?
He wrote it originally. Him and Josh Price wrote, he helped. Josh Price wrote a lot of it. He writes for After Hour Cinema. He's a fantastic writer, dude. He is awesome. When we got it, we had to manipulate it to fix some of the things that we needed, especially budgetary and some other things like that. So we dove into it and we changed some things up, added a little bit to some characters because things changed up. But I'd say that the blueprint all was there from Josh, and then we just adapted to it and put the, you know, the feather boas on it and all the other stuff.
How long was that a process? Like, what is it, a year, 2 years?
The writing was, I think he had had the script. I'm not sure how long it took him to write it, but for us to rewrite and get it to where we wanted it, it took about, I'd say about a month or so, you know, just back and forth.
How many pages is that script?
I think we're at like 90 something. So what, in 90 something pages? So 90 something minute movie. Usually the terminology is for each page is 1 minute of film.
Didn't know that. Just learned something.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're all about what you just said. Exactly. Like, we don't know anything. So everything we go into, I feel like we're like reverse engineering. And then
yeah,
later on, we're like on Google and I'm like, oh man, there's a name to what we've been doing. Like,
right. You
know,
right.
There's a process to it.
Dude, I didn't know a lot at all. And then, I was just kind of going with, like, even with Interfere the Next Wave, Tim, excellent cameraman and one of the best editors that I've ever met, you know, or the best editor.
And what software does he edit on?
He uses Vegas and DaVinci Resolve. He's learned Vegas. He's been using it for 15 years. So
when I met y'all and he was talking about it, I was like, wow. He's like, yeah, I'm just comfortable with it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
He's like, I ain't changing
it. Do they update it? Is it an updated version?
They update it. Yeah. They,
Garrett, can you find out what year that software came out?
It was originally Sony Vegas. I want to say like 2006 or something, because we've had every version. I think it's up to 19 now or 20. But
Premiere. I always Photoshop. So I started C5, which is Photoshop for me.
So Adobe stuff.
Yeah.
You know all the inlets of it.
So I started Photoshop, C5, and then I started learning. And then, you know, Premiere and all that's a cloud. They're all connected.
Yeah.
So if I go into Photoshop, or if I need to pull something up from Illustrator to Photoshop to Premiere, if I need, you know, it just links like that. You can do all, you know, it's a weird setup, but I watch it develop. But then me and him got into Premiere one time and it was like, okay, we can start editing with this. Well, then I found out it's similar, but they make it just a little bit different. But once you know, like, the Adobe language, you kind of just
the language. Yeah.
Yeah. You can walk around and get, you know, a good bit of it done. Now there's people that are like After Effects people that are like insane.
Oh yeah, dude, I've seen it.
Yeah.
But if you know Adobe, then you already have the blueprint. You have the feel, or I don't know, like you know how to ride that bike of After Effects basically.
So I can attest to that a little bit, cause I've came in and I learned a little bit of Photoshop, not as much as I probably need to, but more Premiere. And I think Premiere kind of set me up for Photoshop.
Yeah.
But then again, I've hopped on to other platforms, which was like Character Animator, and it was totally different. And I'm sitting there scratching my head. So
Blender, have you ever messed with Blender?
We've not really. I haven't. No.
Blender can do some cool things.
Garrett has. I messed with a little bit, and I did the Blender Guru tutorial.
Yep, they got some good tutorials.
I'll just get into stuff, and like for that, when I got the 3D stuff, I was like, it's not for me. I don't really.
Right.
I like 2D. I like 2D design. Like, for me, I really do. Like, I like I like Photoshop the best.
Mm.
And then doing the 2D, like, you'll see me add stuff when I make video stuff.
Yeah.
You'll see me use 2D stuff that I made, and I'll just do like the old fashioned, you know, time it,
right,
stopwatch. And
that's your palette, though. That's what you like to use.
I like the 2D feel. Yeah.
Everything's not for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's,
that's right. They're going against the grain. They're like, what's the pattern? So in writing, like, as I'm trying to learn, there's like you were saying it earlier, like the hook. Like, you got to have something hooked in there to catch the audience's attention.
Right.
So, and then I guess the old school story from literature that I remember is like the ascent and the descent of the hero and like the return home story.
Yep.
Is that pretty standard in most stories, or?
I'd say too, it's the conflict, the resolution. If you look back, it's like like with all the Marvel movies, you know, you've got the hero, you got the villain. I mean, it even goes back to biblical times, like this, it's the same format, you know what I mean? Good versus evil. But then you could have something like Dude, Where's My Car, where it's just a completely different. They still had a point. Where's their car? You know, they had to figure it out and come to a conflict resolution. And then everybody at the end's happy.
That's been the biggest struggle for me, right? And it was like how to stage that. But I mean, it's only a matter of learning, which I showed you some of the cartoon, or Garrett showed you some of the cartoon earlier.
Love it.
But like the first couple ones, we lacked that. And then as we like kind of progressed and each try, we would get a little bit better, better. And it made it a bit more, I guess, appealing. I would imagine. I mean, I don't know. It's just it's art. So.
It is, man. And I realized, man, I was thinking back, when I was like 5 and 6 years old, I was writing stories about like my hamsters and stuff. And I realized like in all this filmmaking stuff, like I love to write, but it's almost like a love hate thing because my mind will go, I've got stacks of 5 to 65 page scripts, probably like 30 of them. And they're either like 6 pages and then I get really into it one night. And then I'm like, oh man, I'm going to go, take a dump, whatever. I don't know. And then I stop messing with it. And then it goes by the wayside. And then a month later, I go back to it. I'm like, what the hell was going on here? Where was I going? So I'll start something else, or I'll have an idea like, oh man, that would be cool. Like a brain farming cult that blah, blah, blah. And then I write it out and I'll only get to about 55 pages of it. It's just that lacking the consistency of it to pick it back up.
You know? So when you're writing it out like that, are you writing script or are you writing storyline?
I've realized that if I write it like a story, because I've written, like I wrote a lot of the screenplay for The Next Wave, but what Tim would do is, so basically I write it out like a story first, and then I can adapt it from that because it's just easier for me. Because what's up?
You just trim it down.
Well, yeah. And I just put it in the script, in the screenplay format, which is not so descriptive as far as like, you know, how they're feeling and stuff like that. It's more like setting it up where they're at, you know, interior shot, police station, drunk man leaned over the table with handcuffs on, blah, blah, blah.
You give the whole premise of it.
Yeah. So you set the scene and then it's the job of the director and the actors to convey that part of it. Now you could put something like, you know, starts crying or something, or in a fit of rage, storms out of the building. And then the actor has to interpret that for what it is. What's their fit of rage or what's their whatever else. So
yes.
How much do y'all change the writing during a shoot?
Not much, man. Really? It hasn't. What happens is like, if we get out there, like for I'll use Stokes as an example, I'll get out there and I'll have an actor or actress say, hey, look, I just feel, let me talk to you. And I said, okay, what's up? I feel like maybe this might be a better thing, blah, blah, blah. And I'll go, damn, that is a good idea. Let's run it. Yeah. Let's get the take we need to get, and then let's run that. And then when I'm editing, I could see what it looks like. So,
and would that be B-roll at that point? Yeah.
It'd just be extra takes. So yeah. Like just see how it fits in. But I had on Stokes, I had a lot of the actors just come up and say, you know, they were into their character. I feel like maybe this might be something that she would do here or something like that, or maybe we could try this. And I'm always open for it, man. Like, let's run it. We're not running on film here, so we're not gonna run out of film. We're just maybe run out of space.
Plus the fact that you have input from like an actress or actor, and they're like come up with ideas, or anybody has an idea, it's kind of cool that they got some feedback for you on the show, because it's like, hey, you know, try it.
Yeah, because sometimes you look at things and you got the blinders on and you're so set and focused on this one way that that's why it's good to be open-minded. And you're so set and focused. Now there's some things that I'm married to in this movie. There's some
things. Let's hear them. What are
like
they?
Just some concepts, like shots. Like I see it like this. I see him, you know, opening the door, it panning up, silhouette. He's got the machete in his hand, and then he steps into the frame and it blackens out. And then the next shot is the step out, you know, just stuff like that.
Yeah, we're learning terminology like over-the-shoulder shots and stuff. We're amateurs.
So. I learned all that. Chris Bowler and Erica and all them. And shout out to Mike Lima and a couple people that people may or may not know. But I learned a lot from them, and really a lot from Bowler. And, of course, a lot from Tim Wall from editing and camera work and everything else. But like dirty shots, dirty over-the-shoulder shots, just all the lingo for film.
Yeah, there's no substitute for experience.
Absolutely not.
And when you're out there doing it, I mean, you pick up little things like you were saying earlier, just being aware to be able to take ideas from the other people who have been places you haven't been.
Right.
Only is going to sharpen you. Like,
right. And it, but at first it was trial by fire. And when we went to Franklinton, and it came out beautifully, you know, like I've always like attributed it to like a 5-day acid trip where like, it happened, and then you're like, holy crap, we got 5 hours of sleep in 5 days. But afterwards, as the weeks went on, I'm like, damn, it was a beautiful experience. Like, I learned a lot. You know, we struggled. We went through some stuff. Huh?
Would do it again.
Absolutely, because that's what brought us to the next shoot, which was a couple months later. And I got in place. I learned from the mistakes that I made. I put the people in place that I needed to be there that had their strengths that I don't have and let them do their thing. And it made just this cohesive unit. And like, we have a hell of a team now.
So how are you like getting these?
Hold on a second. Hey, Garrett, can you turn on AirDrop? I'm trying to send the photos. That's what I've been trying to do. Send the photos on your phone that you sent me.
Yeah.
Get them to Garrett so they can see like some of the.
Okay.
I mean, email them.
Oh yeah, it doesn't.
I like the setups here. Is there a like the California Raisin? I get the Stone Cold. I already know that one, but is there a story behind each thing here?
I always had California Raisin when I was a kid. The Joker Bear Brick. We were at a buddy's shop and bought it. His grand opening. Mm-hmm. It was in D'Iberville, and then Stone Cold. I mean, there's a antique store right there by the old Pepe's.
Yeah.
And I just,
because I've got something that,
what do you got?
If y'all wanted to, I've got a couple things. I've got one. It's a carved wooden, it's like a guy leaning on a table. He's got a trucker hat on. He's got like a handlebar mustache beard. He's just like, he just looks like he's been at work all day, but it leans up on the table like this. He's at a bar. He's got a beer in his hand and I've had it in the studio. I've got a Pee Wee Herman pull string doll. That would be mine, but I would let y'all put in here and let it ride in because it's collecting dust. You do?
My mom's got one.
Yeah, mine's voice box is all messed up, so it sounds satanic.
The one we had, like, I think the same one. It's like white with the black, the white, white and black polka dot, checkered.
He's just got his Pee Wee suit on, and he's like, he's got a pull string. He's about this big.
Okay, that's a great suit, but it's like that. I know the one to talk about. I had it. Me and my brother had one.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I wasn't allowed to watch Pee Wee Herman when I was a kid.
That thing was actually creepy looking. If the one I'm talking about,
before or after the
it was before, Pee-wee. And then whenever it happened, my mom was like, "I knew it."
Hey, Garrett,
she was right.
She was justified.
Yeah,
I remember after it happened, because I loved Pee Wee when I was younger, and I would go to my grandmother's in Franklinton, Louisiana. They had one video store, and I'd always go get Pee Wee's Big Adventure. And so after it happened, I didn't understand, and I went in there and I was like running around looking for Pee Wee's Big. I was like, "Where's?" They don't even have the Pee Wee episodes up here, Moggy. And she's like, because the Pee Wee did something very bad. I'm like, oh, I want to watch the movie. You know, I don't care.
Now they just air it on TV.
Yeah. I mean, what, huh? He was in a porn theater.
He's been in a few other movies.
Hey, can you pull up the old, '90s pull string Pee Wee doll? I'm telling you, is it creepy looking? Because I had one that was creepy looking. It was like, it wasn't like.
It wasn't any creepier looking than his ventriloquist.
Kind of remind me like a Goosebump style.
Yeah, yeah. He's got a ventriloquist-y look to
him. Yeah, it's like a real creepy one. But my brother used to scare me with him.
Like I said, mine's voice box is messed up. So it's like it's some dark satanic sounding Pee-wee whenever you
pull. Do you think we could probably restore it? There's got to be a restorer that could, or
he's
change
fine.
It.
He's still in his box.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, the box had the hole on the back, so you could try it out in the store. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. It kind of adds character to it.
If you want,
there he is.
That is it. All of his glory.
Creepy as shit.
Creepy as shit.
The funniest part on Pee-wee's Big Adventure is when, there it is. That's the exact one I've got with the box sitting in the studio. I had to hide it because kids were getting scared of it. Like Tim's boy was getting scared of it.
It's but, looking at me.
No, but, yeah. But the all this shit here is just, I don't know. I mean, I think
casual collections.
Yeah, adding shit. And
yeah.
I mean, you can't go wrong with Stone Cold Cookie Jar.
No, you can't.
All right. So let's talk about ComCon, CoastCon.
CoastCon.
This is how many years have they done it here?
I know I went back in 2015. That was my first time. That's where I bought the peewee doll from, actually.
Really?
Yeah. So anyways, I went back in 2015.
Oh, you can buy shit there.
Oh, yeah. There's a bunch of vendors. That's how some people make their money. You know, they got action figures. They got comic books. They got artwork. They've got furry costumes. They've got furries that run around.
Furries? Jordan, you know what a furry is?
They've got LARPing, which I've talked about y'all like.
LARPing.
Can you describe what a furry is?
A furry is people who wear fluffy, like, mascot costumes while they intercourse one another.
I have been in New Orleans.
Same, but I haven't seen it there.
I've actually watched, who's that guy who does, Andrew, he does Channel 5 now, but he used to do All Gas, No Brakes.
That's Channel 5, yeah.
He went to a furry thing, and it was above and beyond. There was, like, people who were in, like, alien fetish stuff, and they had, like, these phallus things that put eggs in. I don't know how PG-13 the show is or whatever, but anyways, it was like
furry.
The internet is
furry con.
Yeah, it was furry con or something.
I mean I think there's like vampires. Have you seen the vampire ones where they actually bite each other and shit?
Yeah,
that's crazy.
They drink. I've seen the Star Wars ones where they're like real Jedis, and
I've seen that too. Yeah, when I went to CoastCon, they have one of them. It's like something squadron or something, whatever. These guys have legit costumes, stormtrooper costumes. They meet up.
Will they be there this weekend?
Yeah, they'll be there. Oh, yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
They're like a legion or something. You can join it. You know, it's like a
club. Like, you got to earn their respect. Seems like they're.
You do, because you can't mess around. Like, I was like, if you went in there and said something like, oh, man, look at your cute costume. Like, this is not a costume. I work for the emperor, you know, or something like that.
Yeah, they're not breaking character.
It happened to us when we met these people, like they were in their character.
Yeah.
So, I mean, now as long as I'm not going to go there and make fun of them.
Because
we just can't be like, I'm going to act like this is normal.
Exactly. Because when I went to CoastCon the first time, I was like, damn, these are my people. Because it's just like Star Wars geeks and comic books and all the stuff that I love and grew up on. So it was awesome, dude. And everybody's there. There's no judging. There's no nothing else. It's just fun, man. It's a fun atmosphere.
That's how it was whenever we went to our LARP festival, man.
Yeah.
What are you wearing?
I'm probably going to wear the Rick costume on Saturday, but I might just be merched out, or I might wear just some kind of movie shirts or something like that.
Now, the Rick costume, what all went into designing that costume?
Went to Army Navy store in Pascagoula, found the Rick name badge that was probably pulled off of a mechanic shirt or something, and seeing Rick in this movie, he's moved on. He's a VCR TV repairman.
Yeah.
Which in 2022 is ridiculous, but he just wants to be low key and tucked away from everybody
after saving the world,
after all that stuff. Yeah. So anyways, it's just basically like a mechanic shirt with, Rick on it. And then we had VCR and TV repair right here, but it was just, they used the Velcro patches on it. So it fell off like halfway during the movie and we didn't realize it. So there's shots with it and without it. So it was just like, forget it.
Do we know the original Rick?
Do we know the original Rick?
Is there a story behind him? If you found it at the thrift store?
Not yet.
There is a Rick.
You
should write that story.
You talking about the original Rick name tag.
Yeah.
Like to think that it was Hurricane Rick at one point, the homeless guy that I used to hang out with in Ocean Springs.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Rest in peace, Hurricane Rick. But that's what I like to think it was and live on in his honor.
So let's go into Interfere, mm-hmm. Honestly, that was awesome to see, like that throwback, how you at the time, I mean, what'd y'all shoot it on?
We shot it on our studio camera. So they were like, you talking about the first one?
Yeah.
So
what year was that? That was
2020.
Okay.
Yep. So that was when COVID happened and we slowed down at the TV station and Tim's like, dude, let's just make a movie. We've always talked about it. It was going to be a short at first and then it just branched on, but we shot it on our Sony camcorders and we didn't really know what we were doing. We shot it in 60 frames per second. So like it's, you know, like sports shots. So, but still for what it was with Tim's camera work and editing, you know,
I thought it was awesome. I'm a little biased.
I love it.
We went to high school together.
I love it. Yeah.
But I mean, to see it and to see you doing something you're passionate about, put a smile on my face.
One thing that I tell you is now when I hear static, that's what throws my mind now. Static sound makes me like, oh, Interfere. Like, it's seriously, like I told you the other day, I was talking to a guy about interfere. Like, it just, I don't know. This franchise has such a nostalgia. Like, I love.
But y'all had so much fun doing it.
We did.
Y'all did another one.
So what I love, though, is when you do, when you were arguing with the sheriff on this last one, that clip you seen. And I love how you, like, cut in the sounds of, like, your expression. It's kind of like that 90s style. It's got a vibe to it. It's like, uh-oh. And I was like, hell yeah.
Yep.
But that's the stuff I like. Because you have, like, this nostalgia of, like, the old movies and TV shows. It's like, there's always, like, the way you use sound, mm-hmm. it's kind of like punchlines, too.
Yeah, that's all Tim. But
I like that.
Yeah, he's definitely a child of growing up in the 80s and, you know, all those kind of throwback, feel-good, Karate Kitty type, Goonies, stuff like that.
Love,
you know?
Both those movies.
He said it was like if you had to describe it, it'd be like a mixture of Police Academy and Ghostbusters. And I was like, and then
Ryan, that's a pretty good way to describe it.
What would you describe it as? I said, I don't know, man. I hate to be just that guy, but what he said is perfect. You know, that's what it feels like.
Coming from this franchise, which it kind of, you nailed it on that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it does have a certain mixture. I mean, I also have, like, I don't know, kind of reminds me of like the, remember Double Dragon?
Yeah.
It has, I don't know, it's just a weird, the way y'all use, I mean, special effects, a lot of stuff is like, it's, you know what it is.
Right.
And it brings you that experience to, like, now you're going to a horror film, like a horror slasher. That's a different jump from, like,
it is. And I like, me and you, we used to watch.
Well, do you think your grandma kind of influenced a lot of that too? Where you're like,
you already know. Yeah.
So guys, I mean, me and we all grew up together, but like Hunter's grandma had a house and she had her own, and it had nothing but horror film VHS. So me and Hunter would go over there and pick.
Mm.
I mean, my first time.
Dude, I wouldn't have been able to go to bed at night.
My first time was the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yes.
And grabbed it from her house, me and him watched it, and I was like, oh, this is crazy.
One of my favorite movies of all time.
Got me hooked.
Yep. So how violent is this movie?
It's really gotten pretty violent. Yeah.
Stokes?
It is, yeah. We were doing something. We were filming a scene, and I won't give it away with any of the scene, but the actor was like, he was like, damn, dude.
Are you sure?
What is it? Okay. There's something pretty bad that was happening in front of his family or whatever, but yeah, it's pretty violent. It's pretty dark. It's got a supernatural element to it. And, it's kind of different because originally when we talked about it, it was like, you always have people out in the woods. They're there, you know, partying or they're camping or whatever else. Like, what would bring a whole bunch of different types of people in the woods? And so I told Lee, I was like, what about like a team building retreat? You know how companies will do team building retreats? And so that's the premise of it, is this girl, Kimberly, she gets a job at HR at this kind of small firm. And her first order of business is to go on a team building retreat and bring her entire group of different, you got different age groups, you got different people,
walks of life.
You know, it's not just like the teenage donors or whatever, you know, like it's just
work
like
together as a team, like for, yeah.
Yeah. So they're going to come together as a company and team build.
And have activities.
Okay, activities. Okay. So they go out there, they hire a group, impact team builders. And so impact team builders' job is to go out there, stage the property, get it all ready, get the volleyball court set up, the trust fall, all that stuff. And so they go out there, and it's Kimberly's land that she inherited, but the land itself used to belong to a family called the Stokes, and it was taken from them in the day because they couldn't pay their taxes on it. So it was stolen from them. They still had family members buried there. The land meant a lot to them. There's some witchy elements to it or whatever. So when they go out there, you know, the original thing is that cliche woman saying, get back, leave, you know, this land is cursed. And then it just all unfolds from there. And it's kind of like it is cliche to a degree, but some of the dialogue, or a lot of the dialogue, is very good. And it's, the camera work is beautiful. It's just top level good stuff when it comes to the camera, and the acting is, I mean, these are some of the best actors and actresses I've ever met, or I've seen. Even
how do you get a chance to take a call, an acting call, or what is that called? Yeah, how do you get actors?
Okay, actresses? So I went to LA. Is there a
cage for that?
I mean, they are, yeah, dude, there's backstage and all kinds of stuff. But, and I tried out for them, but these are people that I met. I went out to LA for a little while to kind of meet and greet with a director named Dustin Ferguson. He does a lot of horror movies and stuff. And when I was out there, I met a lot of people and made some relationships with them. And then Lee, who is the guy who does After Hour Cinema, Lee Turner, he knows a lot of people out in LA too. And so he said, give Jennifer Moriarty call, give, and I call Ali Perez, these people out there, and we'll try to get them a plane ticket over here and get them to do this movie. So I was able to pull from the people that I kind of knew and had contacts with, and I called them and they're like, yes, we want to do it. I'm like, okay, you're gonna be coming down to Louisiana. One of them was like, are there bugs down there? I was like, yes,
lots,
there's
of
bugs. Yeah, but
snakes.
It was kind of a culture shock, but they were troopers, man. All of them, you know, even considering the circumstances.
So how many actors and actresses do you think total or it took to make the film?
It took, man, it's, I know like the
30 plus, 40 plus.
No. Well, including the flashback scenes we did with you in it and stuff. I don't know, but I know the main characters are, let's see, we got Allie, Jordan, Russo. There's probably about 8 campers out there, you know, and then the team builders, 2 more. So there's 10 people there that are the main fixation. And then you've got some flashback sequences. So you've got characters back there. You can say maybe 20, 30, something like that.
So I almost feel like it's all, I mean, stuff me and Jordan done, we've kind of just been limited to us. You know, Garrett's interacted in some of it too, but we've thought about expanding it with other people, but it's almost like, who wants to play the game? You know, like, do you want to come put your time, your effort into this and try to help create something?
Right.
And that's hard for some people. So you got to be dedicated whenever you commit to it.
Absolutely.
And you also want to be creative. Mm-hmm. Like, you want to have that kind of imagination to create this kind of stuff. Like, you know, for you, it's like you're, all this stuff comes out your head and you make it happen.
Yeah.
And like, you know, you shoot a lot of like local TV shows here and sporting mm-hmm. stuff. So they're like, you're doing that to do this.
Right.
So
right.
It's like, it's sacrifices.
It is. And I'd like for it to get to from, I don't want it to be an expensive hobby. You know, I'd be fine if I could make enough money on my one film to fund the next film,
right.
You know, cause money is it's a priority, but I will say this, my next movie is going to be a lot smaller cast, one location centric, good writing type stuff.
Learn what right, you can
so
do.
We can really isolate it instead of being running all over the woods.
Jordan taught me that whenever we were starting to work on that cartoon. I was like, look, we need to do this, and he's just like, that's cool,
yeah,
but we can't. We got to be realistic, and we can do what we can do. And to have to scale back from there was kind of an awkward experience, but it made me appreciate the skill even better, and then work on what we can do, right. What we got.
I mean, we could all, we could literally, us three could sit right there and do skits. As long as it's real and it's relatable and it's, I mean, it's very creative.
Yeah.
We could pull something off.
As long as we laugh at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's all that really matters. Are you having fun?
When
you
like it, then yeah.
But, I mean, it's just, it's like one of the things though, when you put if you put something together, I mean, it's just a piece of like, especially when we do like small little skits.
Yeah.
That's just funny. Like,
I know.
You just do like, you and Nick were doing that for a long time. Y'all's little hidden, your domain public videos.
Yeah. That's what we do. I did on After Hours, those things like that. But yeah, just to create something, and I'll sit there and watch if I really like it. The way I know that I really like it is if I'll watch it like 50 times, like a little segment or something, and then I'll start nitpicking it. So I'm like, you know, you always are trying to
make
do something different. But going back to what you were saying, there's a lot of ideas that I have. I've started writing a screenplay and I stopped and I'm like, how am I going to put on a festival? And you know, I'm constrained by that. So what I'll do is just write it like a story.
Right.
So maybe one day I could do that, but there, you get to that point where you're thinking way outside the box. And then it's like, oh man, that'll cost a couple $1,000s. That'll this, that, and the other. So you have to rein it back in.
Yeah, but you also don't want to, I don't think, like, keep yourself pigeon-toed to something. No. Like, so I don't know. I'm, I try to think big and then cut it out afterwards.
Yeah. Because I'm unrealistic. Well, for the idea of like making a movie or something like it, there's
never done. We're hoping to.
But also appreciate the fact that like there's something about like I love your films because I mean they're not, you know, nothing's like super, you know, like a $1 million budget going on, but it's the fact that you put something together like this and it's fascinating because it's like y'all put so much work into what y'all have. And like to see this new next project, I mean, I don't know. I just think it's one of the things where it's like, at least you're doing it.
Right.
Dude, how from and the next movie is going to get this. And who was it? James Cameron. Mm-hmm. He started just with the camera and it's like started working his way up.
Yeah.
Just filming next film.
After the second wave, red carpet or the whatever that's called when we got the gun premiere.
Yeah.
That was nice
to see the look on your face of like, man, I'm just almost got a standing ovation pretty much after this thing was over. And it was, I guess, got to be a good feeling for you, right?
It was, man. Yeah. And
do you ever like, are you hesitant to make something like wondering what people will think about it? Or have you let that go? Or
yeah, I've let that go. Yeah. Good. I've gotten to where, cause there was a period of time a couple of years ago where I would start thinking too much about what other people would think. Yeah. And then I'm like, who cares? You know, like this is going to hit who it needs to hit. And if they don't like it, oh, well, if I like it and there's maybe one other person like my mom or somebody else who likes it, then I'm fine.
Yeah, as long as cool. Mom likes it. Good.
Yeah. Or something, you know, like if somebody's like, damn, that was cool. That's all I care about. But there was a time where I would edit myself where I would go, well, I got to do this because I got to see the. Now I'm just like,
that's how we started with the our podcast beginning.
Yeah.
Very like.
Check reserve.
How should we do this? What we should say? Now it's just
people don't want to see that. You know? People are scared. Right.
And what I was saying is like if you do something like you're creating something, if you think it's funny and it's relatable to somebody else is
right.
Somebody's gonna watch it and be like, that's
one person in the
like,
world.
It's a relatable thing. So like that was what I meant about like it kind of resonates with other people. Like when you make stuff, there are people out there that are gonna love what you make and
keep. I love it. Yeah. The scene whenever they do the Pledge Allegiance or what is it? And they turn around and they're looking for the flag and they all salute and the guy who's wearing
the flag
American shirt flag shirt on. To me, that was like the funniest like inside joke for like, did you come up with that?
I didn't come up with that. No, that was Tim.
But somebody got to input like the joke that somebody's going to, I guess, hang on to and remember that.
Yeah. And that's the other thing too is, during the premiere, we had 3-night premiere and we got to hear what other people laughed at. And some of the stuff that we thought was funny was just kind of, it wasn't that funny. So we got to see what the hits were. And then of course a lot of the stuff that we thought was funny, people laughed at, and then there was stuff that we were like, that was interesting. It wasn't really that meant to be a joke, but everybody loved it. They laughed at it. So
how about the costume? The villains, that costume y'all had.
Yeah.
Did y'all get that made?
We had it made.
That was one of the nicest effects that y'all had. It was amazing to see that that effect.
Yeah, we had that costume. Well, we went to a website, and basically what you can do is you can license. They'll have a bunch of different masks and stuff, and you can license the rights to it. So we got Vampirum, and it was awesome, dude. We were kind of skeptical because it was a lot of money.
And the mask,
the hand.
He puts it on.
Could you share the budget on that?
What's that?
Could you tell us how much it cost?
I think it was like,
could you find a picture of it?
Close to $5,000
for everything.
Over $5,000 for everything. Wow. Yeah.
You want to see this because it's really amazing.
Maybe even more than that. It may have been $8,000.
Because like when I was looking, I was like, I thought at first it was like little visual effects, and I'm like, no, I don't think visual effects.
Yeah, at first I thought it was
a
filter almost, like you see the Snapchat face covers, but
what you lather that person with? Was it
Vaseline?
That's how the mask was made.
KY
it
jelly?
It just has like a KY look to it. He's always lubed up.
He looked lubed up the whole time.
Yeah, like, that's the mask.
All I can think is Hunter just, you know, pre-production this.
So do you film all of the mask scenes in one day or try to limit them together and then go back and
yeah, we would split it. So Ryan Rinke, the guy who plays Lucas in Vampirum, he had it set out to where, you know, when he got finished with his Lucas stuff, then he would go get in Vampirum mode. And he's a theater guy. He is an incredible actor. So he would, you know, he'd have take a little bit of time to get into Vampirum, get the voice down. And not, you know, you could put anybody in a mask, but somebody, he brought him to life.
Yeah.
You know, and Ryan was like, when we were trying to find who was going to play Lucas after we wrote it, Ryan had sent in his submission, and me and Tim both looked at each other and we were like, boom, like that, it's him. That's him. That's Lucas. That's exactly who we both envisioned to be that person.
And where, what school did he start at?
I couldn't tell you, man. He's from New Orleans, I believe, but he's
how do you
for Center Stage and stuff, or Biloxi Little Theater a lot.
How do you submit your request to audition?
And so we put it on Facebook, and then we put it on like Mississippi Filmmakers Facebook group page, and people started submitting in their we gave them like a little piece of the script, and they would send it in and
get good participation with that.
Yeah, we did. We had a pretty good amount. So, and then a lot of the other cast, Faith Stanley,
Are these paid gigs or no?
You talk the actors?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They were paid. So Faith Stanley, Marcus Dupree, who was the best that never was
football player. Yeah. We want him on the pod.
Yeah. I'm sure we can get Marcus on here.
Yeah.
He's a cool beast, dude, man. Yeah. He's, a lot of those people were in Jeremy London, who was in the movies acting class. So he was able to recommend people from his class. Right. Like, oh, this person's good.
I got this project.
So it made it easy for him to cast people to fill in all the holes or fill in a lot of the people. For
Jeremy London, that's the alcohol guy. Or what's his name? He was in it too, right?
Jason London's Jason his brother. London. Jason was in Dazed and Confused.
Okay, yeah.
He was the quarterback or something.
Yeah.
Jeremy was in Mallrats.
Okay.
And he was also in Seventh Heaven. And he's been in a couple other things too I couldn't name off the top of my head. And then we had Corin Nimick in it as well, who is a friend of Jeremy. Corin was in
Stargate.
And he's, I found
he's
out
he's a really good actor.
Dude, he is
really good.
If you watch the movie, you'll see in the bar scene, because he improvised this whole thing where, like,
what's his name? Seabass?
Yeah. He grabs Phillip's beard, and then he does like when I say, all right, me and my buddy are just about to be going now. He grabbed my lips like this. He goes, you're going to get your prancy pony asses out of here. I didn't know he was going to do that, but I'm just sitting there. It. You can just see him, like, as I'm watching him, you can see the on my face, like I'm watching a movie or something, like, man, he's a good actor. Like, he's awesome, dude. I mean, there's a lot of everybody in there is a great actor, man. It was Jeremy's an incredible actor.
So did you act in Stokes at all? Or
no, I'm not in Stokes.
Was that different? You like acting?
I do like to act. At first I was kind of like, yeah, but I realized, yeah, I do like to act. You know, I'm going to try to get in some more stuff too. So
not
any of my stuff. I'm going to start putting my auditions out there and trying to get into like
headshots,
you know, like a freaking Viagra commercial.
We'll do glamour shots here.
Not yet. I'm working on it.
You have an OnlyFans?
No, I don't have an OnlyFans.
I'm not
cut out for it.
What, 6'4", 6'5"?
Not cut out for it.
I thought that was the camera further back.
Yeah, in there. It's crazy what you can do with special effects these days. But
I think it's great, though, that you push yourself this far in that world, because that's tough to do. I mean, most people are going to go, you know what? I'm going to get into the film world and do a lot of it locally, too.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, you're not going to another state or to a crazy film school. You're like just diving in and like, hey, my dad's got property. I'm doing this horror film. Dude.
Here's my idea. Let's roll with it.
But he's not really. I mean, if you met his dad was always, I mean, very well-rounded, like very open-minded towards things.
Yeah.
Really big into playing like Civil War games on his PC.
This real, is real. Was, everything about history.
And I don't know if he's, and that's old Hunter, but like he used to have like a 1970. It's like a 70s Porsche or 80s Porsche.
It was a 1990.
Was it 90?
Yeah, it was a 90 911.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was my grandpa's originally, and he handed it over to my dad. But
I could see, and then there's their influence there too.
I know we've talked about it when you've been on the show before.
Too, you know? Yeah, he plays guitar, he paints, you know.
But you've been doing this for a long time. I mean, ever since I can remember, you've been running around with a video camera. To see it now has been, I guess, you know, kind of like poetic.
Yeah, man.
What do you think about reality TV? What's your favorite show?
All right. So it's been a while since I've watched anything, but I'll go ahead and admit that I watched Married at First Sight a couple years ago. And there's something about reality TV. I even go back and watch the old like MTV Next and Parental Controls. Like, this is Mary Bell. She's
next
got
that bus.
The next bus.
Where they pulled up. It's like, yeah,
goes, I had the button.
Hey, I'm just here to have a good time, the button. And I got a lizard. You know, like, or no, they would do, he would come off the bus. He goes, my name's Jake and I got a snake. And then, like, they would have the thing pop up on the side and it would say something like, took a jump in the back of his friend's car one time.
Blah. Occupation, though, age.
Yeah. Just like little facts about him, you know, slept in a doghouse naked. And then one time, like some guys would get off the bus and she would be like in a field with the thing set up, the date set up. And so the guy would get off the bus and he'd be all cocky and stuff with a spiked up bleach tipped hair.
And the
dad, she'd go, next. But he's like, oh, you're missing out.
That was with the parents that had the bad, the boyfriend that they didn't like.
No, that was the next bus, but parental control was
parental that control
okay.
was that one.
So, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That, what was the one where they went into each other's rooms?
Room Raiders.
Yeah.
Yeah. She goes, all right, let me see what's over here.
Was that reality though?
Yeah.
That was
the beginning of reality.
I mean,
reality isn't really reality.
Yeah, it's, you know, not. It's, none of it gotta, is.
Because if you sat there and.
This is reality, right?
Reality TV is scripted TV because you're going to, like, for example, Pawn Stars or the Storage Locker Show.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're not going to find a freaking Civil War medallion or something every single time. So they have to keep the audience going.
Retention is.
So they'll have something like, oh, man, I think I lost money on this locker. Hey, wait a minute. What? It's a safe. You know, what's in it? And he cracks it up. He goes, oh, my God. And
it cuts the commercial.
It cuts the commercial. And so they get their advertisers in. And when he comes back, he goes, man, this is one of the original bowling balls. And then he goes, you know what? I think we might have to take this to a bowling ball expert. And I know just the guy. And they'll go, he goes, yep, this bowling ball is from 1913.
25 minutes anymore. Later.
Yeah, and then it, like they go, how much do you think I can get for it? Then the dramatic music is like,
and then one of the teammates are fighting each other. It's like,
I love how they add it all up at the end.
I don't even like this person that bid on this locker.
Yeah,
what was the guy, the Mexican guy with the hat and the glasses?
Yep.
And he's like, I don't like him at all.
Yeah,
so at the end when they would ching it up.
So they're basically, these people, when producers go out to find this stuff, they've got to find characters. So these people got to be characters of themselves, because you're not just going to have somebody on there that doesn't have the drama. They want the people to have the drama. And if they don't have anything going on, the episode's boring. They got to go, hey, get in a fight with Daryl.
Yeah, we'll create the drama. Call him a bitch.
So they go, he goes, all right, what do you want us to do? All right, so Daryl's going to bid on the locker. You're going to outbid him. Then he's going to say something about a locker that happened last month. And then Daryl's son's going to come up and bump you in the chest. Blah, blah, blah. And they're like,
they're going to table talk.
All right, y'all ready? All right, here we go. Make up, action. You go, all right, then they'll do it. So it's not really reality, but I like it. You know,
it's addicting.
Everybody
one of my
drama.
Favorite shows is Lizard Towing.
Yeah, that's another good one.
What was it?
She pushed a vehicle off of a park.
Have you seen Lizard Towing, Garrett? Don't play the video.
Just though, for the drama.
No sound.
Or no, they busted someone's. This is another fake portion. So she goes, the woman getting her car towed, she came out to bust the windshield out of it, but she had safety goggles. Like, producers go, we don't want that liability. You can have safety goggles.
Who was it? The Travel Channel?
I don't remember, man. It
had the pawn shop guy with the slick back hair.
Yeah.
Like the daughter that always got mad and the son that ran it.
Was that like Swamp Pawn?
No, this one was like the big city one.
Oh, so it's like Big City Pawn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Detroit
is another spinoff of something.
The Lizard Towing was fucking funny. I watched it the other day, and it was like one of the guys, buddies that works there, is like, I think it was like his ex girlfriend's car or something. It's like, I'm gonna tow my ex girlfriend's car, and I was just like, I mean, and they did
True TV.
Yep.
Look, some drama's about to happen here.
Staged. Oh, he's in
reverse.
Are they
like racing for the toe or something?
Do you think that's staged though?
Yeah, it is. It's staged to a degree. They have to set it up to a degree.
So probably a lot of editing involved to make it fit the role of the storyline that they're trying to.
Right. There's a lot of the people know what's happening because they have to have consent. And even when they blur the faces, sometimes they.
My favorite shot in reality TV though is the car ride. Every show has the car ride. Every show.
Now, I don't know if I've seen this one. I was talking about the one something towing where It was just we're really trying to over watch the show. Top. Oh, no. We're just sitting here for the next 45 minutes. Like, oh, what's going on?
You know, but I also like shows like, was it Dane Cain?
Dean Cain.
Ripley's Believe It or Not.
Yeah, that was Dean.
Yeah, but yeah. I like the mystery. I was showing that earlier in the video. Like anything that's got a guy just walks by with his head down, lifts up, is like in tonight's episode.
I like reaction, like the Jackass, the band Margera and CKY back in the day. Yeah, like they would do something in front of people and to watch those people's reaction based off of what they're doing. Like
but nowadays it seems like everybody, if I saw something happening where like a guy was doing something goofy in Walmart, I'd look for a camera.
Yeah,
because you know they're
back because they're used to it. You're trained for
the golden age of now. Everybody's doing stuff for TikTok, shock value, doing whatever else, pranks, things like that. But like Tom Green, remember Tom Green show?
Yeah, yeah.
I love Tom Green, dude. He was
Freddie Got Fingers is still one of the tops.
Freddie Got Fingered, but his observational humor and his ability to keep a straight face. But nobody knew back then because they're
Borat or was Sacha Baron Cohen.
Yes, he is awesome.
The Ollie G back then, whenever the first Ollie G show came out.
The bag's out on him. So
yeah, he can't go anywhere.
Go interview Donald Rumsfeld.
Well, think this, though. America's Funniest Home Videos in the 90s. Like,
yeah.
We sit around with the family and watch just people's dumbass clips.
Yeah.
And it wasn't really that crazy, but it was funny.
I feel like some of those started to get staged, though, later on. Like,
I mean,
they do now.
When Carlton was on there. R.I.P. Bob Saget.
There's a lot of people though, that will go out of their way and to stage murders and all kinds of stuff to get
reaction. Hey, it's all about
there's like
Jesse Smollett.
It's all about clicks and views. Yeah. You know,
it's like they want to be famous. Either they kill somebody or
You can see. I saw one the other day. It was like
people are famous because they dance for the camera.
Yeah. Yeah,
like think about it. I mean, people, whether they're clothed or not clothed, but they're dancing. It's crazy. It's like our world's turned into hearts to a dance.
That and I'll kind of branch off of that, turning into the thing I fear about films. And there will always be a caveat for the art, but even like nowadays, it's like a 3 minute video is too long.
Yeah,
like people won't look at a whole 3 minute video because the attention span is so confined now. So unless you're really out there trying to do it, or maybe if you know you sit back and have a couple brewskis or maybe smoke some pot or something like that, and you're really engaged. But for the most part, the modern audience is just going to be like, "Oh, that video is 45 seconds. Next, you know, they're going to go through.
Got to be really hook good
them and get them or have a following or an audience already.
Nudity."
Nudity, yes. That's why a lot of horror movies low budget nowadays. Nudity. Absolutely, do it. Why not? You only live once. Enjoy the ride.
There needs to be more full frontal male nudity in movies. It's been
just tuck it. Do a full reenactment of Silence of the Lambs.
I was thinking about the other day. I was like, wow, you know, people are, you know, life's turning into. I mean, I would say like Idiocracy, one of my favorite movies.
I love that movie.
And then, but I've watched it so many times. I'm like, wait, this is real. Cause I went to, I've been to a fast food place lately. And it's like, I walk into like, I would say a McDonald's and it's like, nobody's behind the counter anymore. And it's like, hit this button.
Yeah.
And once AI gets good, I promise you the AI is going to be running through all the mics. Mm-hmm. And once they figure out how to just do robotic food delivery,
they're already trying it. They've it's like set up, you know,
there goes labor costs. They're all making it. I mean,
yeah. It's getting. I went to.
We're all gonna be on VR.
Yeah, we're gonna
be never gonna see their friends in real life.
I think that what the whole goal is just for us to be pod people that sit there and consume things. So we just sit with our VR headsets on. We order Uber Eats,
and you get 30. Everybody has 30 or 40 subscriptions.
That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. I've got at least 10. So yeah.
I cut a lot out this month. I was just like did a cleanse. Yeah. Like I got.
What'd you purge?
A lot. Like
you got HBO Max still?
No, yeah, I have that one.
Okay, that's a good one to have.
I have that one.
South Park's dropping on there right now.
Disney Plus.
I think I'm getting after the
Mandalorian. Got rid of Netflix.
After Mandalorian, I'm done with Disney Plus.
Mandalorian was last night. It was dope. My son's
gonna be 5 March 5th.
Did you watch last night's episode?
No, I forgot it was even out.
Boom, it's out.
Yep.
It's fire.
I usually like to get 2 episodes in the bank. So
you got one to
and then
coast into.
Yep.
But I kind of wish they, like, I know they got the apps going where you have to click for like the show to watch, but I do enjoy the, because like we had Discovery Plus, and then they had the live. It was nice just scrolling through the channels. Cause like when you get on like Netflix or these shows, you have to like see these little cubes.
I spend more time picking out when I'm gonna watch than actually watching.
I spend more time going, they changed the thumbnail. They changed the thumbnail. They're trying to, you know, it's all different thumbnails. It's like a movie. It's like a different one. Like,
it's like, this isn't Hook's thumbnail.
Like, it's like, because I sit there and I'm like, I'm not picking a movie. I need the movie to play. Like, I need the movie to play. And you scroll down. It's like,
yeah,
all these little squares. Like, that's not, that wasn't there. So I'll spend 45 minutes looking at thumbnails. Like, what? What?
I'll do that on YouTube. Yeah.
Jordan did always preach to me how important thumbnails are. He's yeah, right.
You get a preview of everything going on.
Like, I'm sitting here, I'm telling you, like, Emily's like, you ready to watch a movie, babe? I'm like, I'm still looking. 30 minutes later, Oliver's asleep. She's like, are we still watching the movie? I'm like, I think I found the one.
That's so relatable. It's so relatable. Like, you got to find that perfect one, you know?
And how about now with all the ones that like the trailers play now, when you just, when you barely even, don't even have to like click on that, like the thumbnail, it just plays the trailer for you now.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, should I watch Shooter? Last night I watched Shooter. And they got me because
Mark Wahlberg?
Yeah.
Yep.
But they got me because of that thumbnail. Like, they got me when they was playing.
They sold you on it.
I was like, oh, I got to. I just got to give one more try this. It's been a long time.
Well, with so much content, you've got to hook them. Like,
gotta hook
them in. So you got to have something that just bam.
So what do you think about algorithms in film right now? Like, I feel like a lot of these movies are kind of synced into algorithm, like what works. Like, you see these Hallmark movies that are pretty much like rinse, wash, repeat. And then the ones that kind of go against the grain, but like, I guess define your definition on that. I mean,
okay. So I was happy to see, I know what you're saying. So everybody talks about like what Scorsese said about the Marvel movies, that it's just like going on an amusement park ride. I like the Marvel movies, but there's a formula. You've got people, you got money men behind the scene, and they're saying, this is what we need to appeal to these audiences. We've got to appeal to overseas audiences. We've got to hit all these different marks. So that's almost, these films have to hit marks and are kind of prefabricated. As we were talking about earlier, don't care what anybody thinks. A lot of times directors are confined by what the studio wants them to do.
The money man.
Because it's a product. Right. It is a product. You know, we're going to put this out, and if it hits enough, we're going to put sequels out, a mini series, this, that, and the other. But going back to that, so there's certain people, like, did y'all see the movie X, the horror movie X?
No.
Or have you seen the guy who did Hereditary, Midsommar? These are different types of movies that A24 puts out. I don't know if you've heard of that company, A24. Nope. It's a production company. They're just the production company, but they get this platform for kind of indie, what we would call indie back in the day, or independent filmmakers that are kind of against the grain, not doing the formulaic stuff that everybody else is doing. So there's hope there, because those movies, Jordan Peele, he does different stuff. You know, he does stuff that's almost M. Night Shyamalan kind of.
Is there a place for that other than like Sundance, or is there other local places? Or
if it catches on,
is there a New Orleans Film Festival? Or
yeah, there's film. Man, there's so many film festivals. There's a thing called Film Freeway where you can pay fees and put your film in all different types of festivals around the country, even in other parts of the world. So
what's the fee? A couple grand.
It depends on the festival. I had a 60-second horror short that got selected that we did at the studio. And basically the film festival was 60-second horror film festival, and it was in Austin, Texas. And there was thousands of submissions. Ours got selected. It didn't win anything, but it was a selection, which was
still cool. Yeah.
But we just basically paid the fee online, sent them over our file, and we didn't go to the event or anything like that. But then people get those little bitty things that you see on the cover, official selection of this, that, and the other. That's what people want to.
They want a sticker.
Basically, yeah.
Like just gives them accreditation.
Like a merit badge, yeah, like a Boy Scout badge. You know, I got my Be Prepared badge. But
and then, because they have them, like you said, send money, and then you can.
Should we start a Biloxi Film Festival? Is there enough people here doing that to sustain?
Sure, there is. Yeah, there's a Jackson Film Festival. I don't know what it's called. There's a Magnolia Movie Festival. You got to understand, Mississippi's growing with their incentives and the things, you know, that you've got Morgan Freeman filming movies down here. You've got the Mississippi is trying to make it to where Hollywood is expensive to film at. And basically it's like a manufacturing line. It's cheaper in Mississippi now. They offer the incentive. So why would you go over here and pay double the money to do this movie when you can go to Mississippi and do it for half or below that? You know,
are you guys taking advantage of any of these incentives?
Not yet, but I've talked to the people at the Mississippi Film Commission about how I think it's something like if you spend over 20 or 30 grand, then you get like a half rebate back on anything you spend or something like that.
Is there a permit? Yes, you have to get a permit now. Is there a gray area? What's this?
I mean, well, we don't. The thing about Mississippi, too, is like when the people from California came down, they said, they're just letting y'all use the courthouse. I'm like, yeah, they don't care. They're like, please, hey, yeah, use the courthouse, use the shop. We would have to pay hundreds or thousands of dollars to get a permit, get it approved. Yeah. But we have these little small towns in Mississippi. We can just go there and
they want you to help.
They
out.
Want you yeah. there. They'll open you up, they'll feed you, they'll do whatever. That's what the great thing about filming down here is, too. You know, I wouldn't.
How many movies have made like local restaurants popular? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, just like it's just like one of the things where it's like a
toy. Pulp Fiction, that one restaurant in Pulp Fiction.
Harry Met Sally.
Yeah.
Back to the Future.
Pizza Place from The Office.
Yeah.
White Castle.
I mean, yeah, White tons. Castle went above and beyond with that one.
I think you're right on the, like with the, you know, getting people engaged in that part. Cause you're like saying like, you know, now it's like, I mean, you gotta do some crazy shit or dumb shit, or you gotta shake that ass.
Exactly. You've got to do
nudity. Hey,
you got to do boobs and do blood and gore. That's the formula for low budget horror. And I'm not knocking it. I'm just saying that's what is going to, when someone's looking through hundreds of thousands of different movies and they go, she's hot. Oh, cool. She gets killed and her shirt gets ripped off. That's what they're wanting to see. That's like what people want to see for the most part. And to some degree, you've got to stand out. And the age old adage in horror movies from like the 70s is slasher movies, you know, people having sex and making bad decisions and getting killed and seeing some nipples and, you know, some ass guy doing it.
Could we do a slasher that's just based on hashtag killer, like the dude just kills you because the hashtags
and that's about being
hashtags? Yeah.
That's about being creative. You can do whatever you want.
There's man. One hashtag.
Could he have like a hashtag mask
if you hashtag in it?
It's like a big hashtag
if you hashtag
or a hashtag knife. It has blades on the end of it. Yeah,
that's the wound that it leaves.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. He brands them with a hashtag.
What do you when you get in your ideas, because I mean most time, I mean, ideas for your writing and stuff, whether you're taking a shit, whether you're working,
yeah,
doing things, these ideas, you get super excited and you're jotting down, man.
Like I start getting like my hands start to sweat and stuff like that, especially when I know something's like when I was doing for Interfere and stuff like that, we would have a concept. Tim's like, I want to do this, and so he would have the basic idea of it, like a bar scene where y'all have to go ask around where Clooney's at. And so I'm like sitting there, blah, blah, blah. And then I'd, whatever the scene was. And then I would think about it. And then sometimes I'd just go get something to eat or do whatever. And then it'd be like that little idea just floats and you catch it. And you're like, oh, there it is. And you just run with it.
I've had it happen.
Like super amped. Like I'm just like, and I'm so hyper focused. I feel like I'm on drugs or something. I'm just like doing my crap. But
yeah. I've definitely had it happen. It'll be the dumbest things that inspire it too.
Yeah.
Like I'll just see something or somebody will drop by in the car and then my wandering mind takes me into building this hole and I start to giggling about it. And then half the time I forget about it and within seconds it's gone.
I'm crazy with notes. So I just like, if I have an idea, like I'll note it and I'll just start writing the stuff and I'll even send it out to Garrett and Matt. Like I'll just go my notes and I go and just these ideas in my head on like, you know, for a long time before I shut down the mattress store, it was always like stupid mattress commercials. Like, how can I make them stupider? Like, you know, for me to like, you know, just funny, like.
Yeah.
Just because it's, I mean, it was a good product to push and it was just fun to come up with. Like, we had a lot of fun making.
Oh, absolutely. And we learned a lot. Yeah, back to, you know, experience. You can't buy experience.
Looking at my notes right now, guys.
I am too.
I'm trying to find a piece.
I'm trying to.
I'm looking for a one of my little ideas that I had.
All right, so while y'all are looking, I'm going to plug Interfere and Interfere, the second wave. You can watch them both on Amazon Prime, both starring Hunter Bickham, St. Martin's very own.
And he is amazing. Real quick, I don't know what I wrote here, but I said, make pizza rolls then compared to my mattress at Mattress by Appointment while making them feel excited.
Yeah, that'll be a good one.
It's fucking real. I'm not making that up.
All right.
All right.
This is a future setting.
Pull your notes up.
Guy who dies having virtual reality sex. His kids want to know what video game character he was having sex with, but it takes a turn whenever they're at the funeral home and they realize it was weird shit like Mario.
Myself.
Can you imagine, like, we're so sorry about your father's death, and then one of the kids is like, well, what was he doing? He was having VR sex. Like, with what? A video game character. Okay, who was it? Like Princess Peach or something? Like, it was Sonic, you know. And then they're all like, dad? He's like some 70-year-old guy or something. Anyways, JoJo just looked at me like,
right. So I got the Mr. Billy ad, and it just says skate ring video, 90s skate music, laser lights.
Mine are lame.
I just woke up. I think I just woke up in the middle of the night. I was like,
I've done that before too. I did one. It was a Robert Stack Campbell Soup. So it was the host of Unsolved Mysteries, Unsolved Mysteries themed Campbell Soup. Here's one. Dog poop messages from a prophetic dog who's able to communicate with his owner through his dog poop.
Don't be stealing any of these ideas, people.
Yeah, I've already got these trademarked. They're now in the ethos.
Let's see.
They're out there. Here's Juice Monologue. This one's Garrett's Belvedere character. It's been four long summers.
That really sounds like. Yeah, I don't know, man. It's just
a lot of mine is Belvedere.
That shit made me laugh, though.
So create, guys. Whenever you're just sitting out there and you know you're thinking, write that shit down because you never know what's gonna hit.
And we will be at CoastCon this weekend.
Yeah, CoastCon is going on Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Friday, let me open my phone back up again. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Yes.
Mississippi Gulf Coast Coliseum Convention Center.
Mm-hmm.
The parking.
I definitely peed on myself a little bit. Just a little bit.
Just did you?
Yeah, because it's wet. Yeah.
Oh, no. You need a diaper, dude.
Depends, man.
Depends, man.
Dang prostate, you know?
Yeah.
I don't care.
See, like that? Yeah. Just roll with it.
Hunter, man, we appreciate you coming on the show.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me. Hey, I do want to shout out those times we'll be showing the movie. So if anybody wants to come out to CoastCon and see it. Hold on. Let me go through.
Come watch Interfere, the second wave. There's a dope dialogue of the first, I guess, what would you call that? A setup?
Just a recap.
A recap of the first movie.
You don't have to watch the first one. You get it all, and it's really cool. Comic book centric. Scott Pilgrim meets, I forgot the damn movie name. But anyways.
Versus the world.
Yes, he doesn't meet the world. He already
Boy meets
it.
The world.
Same thing.
So the times we are showing the movies are it's in my photos. I got this. Hold on. Wait.
It's all right.
Here it is. CoastCon, 3 p.m. on Friday, March 3rd. We'll be showing the movie. We'll have 7 p.m. Saturday, March 4th is the big one because Lucas or Ryan will be dressed up as Vampirum walking around. There may be some clown girls there. Some characters from the movie. I might wear my Rick outfit and act nervous. And then Sunday at 12 p.m., which is not hard to do. Sunday at 12 p.m., March 5th is the next showing. So we got three screenings and there's a Q&A Friday, March 3rd at 5 p.m. So if y'all want to come out to CoastCon and watch the movie, if not, if you don't want to go to CoastCon, go to Amazon Prime and watch Interfere the Next Wave. You can watch the first one too, but we recap it. So you can watch Interfere the Next Wave because it's.
And there will be furries at CoastCon.
There will be furries at CoastCon too.
That's your thing.
And we will be there after my son's birthday party.
How old's he turning?
5, and we're going to steal the minivan. We're actually going to we're gonna see Showbiz. And
you want a Chuck E. Cheese?
Chuck E. Cheese.
Yes, we're going to Chuck E. Cheese. Okay. But after that, we'll be there Saturday and we'll be having a blast. Hunter might get a face tattoo.
Maybe. Temporary.
No, full blown.
Like see you guys Tyson later.
Dorito said it's cool. I already talked to her.
Okay. Well, face I know tattoo. That's a lie. Because she got mad at the last. There's Brooks and all of his
my acting.